you who believe. Give charity for the pleasure of Allah, the pleasure of Allah. Oh, you who believe, read the Quran every night of Ramadan, night of Ramadan. Welcome, oh Ramadan. Ramadan, it is Ramadan.
Dear brothers and sisters in Islam and humanity, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace, the mercy, and the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on all of you. Welcome to the show, Ramadan, A Date with Dr. Zakir. I'm your host, Yusuf Chambers, and today we will discuss the topic Zakah, Part 1. Dr. Zakir, Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Incredibly important part of Ramadan, the Zakat, the poor Jew, as it's sometimes translated. And this is really the first point of order today, which is to discuss the meaning of the term zakat, sometimes zakah, and to discuss, if we could, some of the significance of the term zakat in Islam.
Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah wa ala ali wa sahbihi ajmain. Amma ba'd, a'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Rabbi shahli sadri wa yassirli amri wa hlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. As far as the literal meaning of the word zakat is concerned, zakat is derived from the Arabic word zaka, which means to purify, which means to increase. It also means blessings and goodness. So zaka means purification, or cleanliness, increase. It means goodness, it means blessings. In Islamic Sharia, zakah is an obligatory charity which every Muslim who has a saving or a surplus wealth which has reached the nisab level or above that and stays with him for one complete lunar year or one hijri year, he should give zakat on that surplus wealth, which is most of the time 2.5%. This is the Sharia Islamic meaning of it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, in Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, verse number 103, take alms or give charity, give zakat from the wealth so that it will purify and sanctify them. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Rum, chapter number 30, verse number 39, those who give gifts in order that it will increase their property through the gifts of the other person's property, it will have no increase with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But those who give charity, seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will find an increase therein. And zakat is one of the pillars of Islam. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, in the book of Iman, book of faith, hadith number 8, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, that Islam is based on 5 principles. The first is, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. There's no God but Allah. And Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the messenger of Allah. The second is establishing salah. Third is giving zakat. That is obligatory charity. The fourth is performing hajj. And fifth is fasting the month of Ramadan, which all of us are doing, alhamdulillah, now. So zakat is one of the important pillars of Islam. There are various verses of zakat which tell us what zakat is, even various hadith, which is the significance in Islam. Allah says in Surah Anfal, chapter number 8, verse number 3 and 4, that zakat is a sign of belief. It says that all those who believe and establish salah and give zakat, they are the true believers. That means zakat is a sign of true belief. And a beloved Prophet Muhammad said, it's mentioned in Sahih Muslim, volume number 4, hadith number 6264, he said that when you give charity, it does not decrease the wealth. And if a servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if he forgives, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increases respect. And if he shows humility, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raises his status in the eyes of the people. So charity does not decrease the wealth. It rather increases the wealth. And by zakat, there is unity and brotherhood among the Muslim ummah. The full Muslim ummah throughout the world is like one family. And a person cares for the others, the rich when they give zakat to the poor, and they feel that as though they are part of one family. And the beloved Prophet Muhammad said, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, in the book of Salah, hadith number 481, Muhammad said that one faithful believer to another faithful believer is like the bricks of a ball. They support each other like the bricks of a ball. And he interlaced his fingers of his hands like that. So it brings unity in the Muslim ummah. And the one more verse in the Quran which describes zakat in a nutshell, Allah says in Surah Al-Hashr, chapter number 59, verse number 7, speaking about zakat, that it prevents the wealth from circulating amongst the rich. So it is sort of an economic order in Islam, zakat.
Dr. Zakir, could you tell me, and for the benefit of the viewers today, how does zakat help in maintaining the economy of a given society?
As far as economic society is concerned, unlike capitalism or socialism, the economic order of Islam is based on the principle that everything in this earth, everything in the universe belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the owner of everything in the universe. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator, sustainer, cherisher, and the owner of everything that exists in this world and in the universe. Based on this principle, Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse number 33, that give in charity out of the means which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided you. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's wealth, and Allah has made us trustees. Allah is asking us to give out of the means that He has provided us. Allah repeats the message in Surah Hadith, chapter number 57, verse number 7, that give out of the sustenance which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made you a heir of. But Allah has given you the property, the sustenance, give out of that. So we as human beings are the trustees or vicegerent of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is the wealth of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the reason we have to spend it and earn the wealth according to the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, since it belongs to Him. And there are various guidelines given in the Quran how the wealth should be earned and distributed and spent. As far as how the wealth should be earned, there are various prohibitions that you cannot earn this way, otherwise everything is halal. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 217 and 279, that give up the demands of riba. Riba is interest, it's usury. And those who give up not the demands of riba, usury and interest, take notice of a war from Allah and His Rasul. So earning through riba, through usury, through interest is haram. It is one of the biggest sins as far as earning is concerned. And Allah further says in the Quran that you cannot earn through bribing. Allah says in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 188, that use not your wealth as a bait for judges in order you may eat other person's wealth. So using your money to bribe people so that you may earn more wealth is prohibited in Islam. Similarly, stealing and robbing is prohibited. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Maidah, chapter number 5, verse number 38, as to the thief, be it a man or a woman, chop off his or her hand as a punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So earning while robbing is prohibited. Furthermore, Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Maidah, chapter number 5, verse number 90, Ya ayyuhallazina amanu, O you believe, innamal khamru wal maisuru, most certainly intoxicants and gambling. Well, ansabu wal azlamu, dedication of stones, divination of arrows, rishtum minamali shaitan. These are Satan's handiwork. Fashtanibulalukum tuflihun. Abstain from this handiwork that you may prosper. So earning by means of intoxicants, gambling, making idols, or fortune telling, all these are prohibited in Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala further gives us guidance. And Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse number 33, that do not force your maids into prostitution, those who want to remain chaste, just in order to gain some wealth or goods. But if anyone forces them after this, then Allah is of forgiving and most merciful. But you cannot earn through prostitution. And furthermore, Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse number 19, and those who love scandal to be published and broadcast amongst the believers, they will surely get a grievous penalty in this world and in the hereafter. That means anyone who likes to publicize or broadcast scandal amongst the believers, it is prohibited. And further, Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 2, that give to the orphans their property once they become adult. Means if you're a guardian to the property of an orphan, give it to them when they mature. And do not exchange your goods which are useless with their goods which are good. And neither do you mix up your goods with their goods. For all those who do this, they're doing a great sin. So there are various things mentioned in the Quran that you cannot earn by means of riba, interest, or by bribing, or by robbing, or alcohol, gambling, idol worship, fortune-telling, by prostitution, by scandalous ways, or by eating the orphan's property. This is a guideline given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which you find in the other world today, in the modern world. All this is very common. And Allah also gives us a way, gives us guidelines how to spend the wealth. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 261, if anyone sows one grain in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will give him 7 years, each year bearing 100 grains. That means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that if you spend in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will give you 700 times profit. In business terminology, Allah will give you 70,000% profit. In which business will you get 70,000% profit? And Allah continues and says that He will give you multiple times more. So the best way to spend is in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is charity. Allah further repeats the message in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 271, that if you disclose the charity that you give, it is well. But if you conceal it and make it reach those people who are needy, that is the best for you. It will cover up your sins. And Allah knows. Giving charity is good. Allah has given you permission to disclose it, also to tell it to others. But the best is disclosing. Allah says in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 277, as to those who believe and do righteous deeds and establish prayers and they give charity, that is zakat, they will receive the reward from their Lord. And on them shall be no fear and they shall not have any penalty. Allah says in Surah Dhariyat, chapter 51, verse number 9, Allah says, and give charity to those who ask and even to those who are prevented from asking. And if you know the person deserves, if he's needy, if he's poor, whether he asks or does not ask, yet give him charity. I'd like to mention one more verse. Allah says in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 36, that serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and join not gods with him. And be good to your parents and the kinsfolks and the relatives and to the orphan, those who are in need, and to the neighbors, those who are near you, and to the neighbors, those who are strangers, as well as to the wayfarer and to what your right hand possesses. So Allah gives the categories of people who should be good to. And Allah gives a warning in the Quran, in Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, verse number 34 and 35, that as to those who hoard gold and silver and spend it not in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, announce to them a grievous penalty. And in the year after, the wealth which they hoarded will be taken and it will be heated in the fire of hellfire. The gold that they hoarded will be heated in the hellfire, and with it they'll be branded on the forehead, on the flanks and on the back. And it will be told to them that taste the wealth you hoarded. That's the reason zakat has been prescribed for the Muslims. And Allah says in Surah Al-Hashr, chapter 59, verse number 7, that it prevents the wealth from circulating amongst the rich. If every rich human being in the world gives zakat, poverty will be eradicated from this world. There will not be a single human being who will die of hunger.
Professor Zaki, could you furthermore explain then, what are the particular conditions that make zakah or zakat an obligation upon the Muslim?
Zakat is compulsory on every Muslim, irrespective whether it's a man or a woman, whether adult or minor, whether sane or insane, as long as he's a free citizen. And he has surplus wealth or savings which has reached the nisab level or above it, and he has that wealth or surplus amount or saving for one complete hijri year or lunar year, then zakat becomes compulsory on that particular Muslim, and most of the time, the most of the cases, it is 2.5%. So basically, there are a few conditions required. Number one, that person should be a Muslim, irrespective whether male, female, young, old, sane, insane, it doesn't matter, Muslim. Number two, he should be a free citizen. Number three, he should be a sahib-e-nisab. That means he should be the sole owner of that surplus wealth. Above the basic requirement, whatever savings he has got, whatever surplus he has got, he should be the sole owner of it. It should not belong to somebody else. And it should be with him for one complete lunar year or hijri year, as it's mentioned in the Hadith of Tirmidhi, Hadith number 61, the beloved Prophet Muhammad said that zakat is payable on the property, but natural, which is surplus on the wealth, which a person possesses and has with him for 1 year. And the last criteria is that zakat should be paid from lawful earnings. It should be from halal earnings. As the beloved Prophet Muhammad said, it's mentioned in Sunan Nisa'i, Hadith number 2525, where the beloved Prophet said that prayer without cleanliness is not accepted. Same, zakat without lawful earnings is not accepted. So zakat that you give should be from lawful earnings. That is a requirement. And if it's a minor or if it's an insane person, the person who's the guardian of the wealth of that insane person or the minor person, he should pay zakat on behalf of that insane or minor person from his wealth.
I see. Dr. Zakir, you mentioned the term nisab. Could you explain to the viewers what the term means? And furthermore, the understanding is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has only made zakat incumbent upon the person who has reached the nisab level. Could you also explain what is the implications of that?
As far as the word nisab is concerned, nisab is an amount laid down by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the minimum amount that when it reaches, and it keeps on changing on different properties. When it reaches that level on which zakat is compulsory, then that minimum limit is called as the nisab. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it compulsory that zakat should be given only when a person reaches nisab, is for many reasons. Number one, those people who are poor, they will not be unnecessarily taxed with it, with the zakat. And furthermore, those who are rich will surely have to pay the zakat from their surplus wealth. Secondly, it is an insurance against those countries who want to levy a tax on the needy and the poor. So nisab has been laid down. That means they cannot tax a person who is below the nisab level. So it is insurance against those country who want to levy a tax on the needy and the poor. Furthermore, a person who wants to know whether he should pay zakat or not. So if he knows his surplus wealth, his excess wealth has reached the nisab level, he knows that he has to pay. As far as the person who is rich, for him, if he is wealthy, so all the excess wealth but natural is liable for zakat. Nisab has got two requirements. Number one, that it should be above the basic requirements known as fadl, above the requirement of human being. So it is besides the clothing, shelter, lodging, boarding, all the basic requirements of human being. If he has surplus wealth or saving, then if he reaches nisab level, then that is counted for zakat. And what is the basic requirement depends upon the Islamic Sharia. Because if we see today many of the modern countries, for their basic requirement may be luxury, for them basic requirement may be a very big car or a big mansion, maybe excessive food, maybe alcohol, whatever it is. So it should be according to the Islamic guidelines. And we are not bothered what does the UNO tell us, or the International Monetary Fund tells us, or what the security social company tells us, that what is the basic requirement. It is according to the Islamic guidelines, which is mentioned in the hadith, etc. If it is above that, then if it is at the nisab level, then zakat has to be given. And secondly, it should be with the person for one full year. As I mentioned earlier, our beloved Prophet ﷺ said, it's mentioned in the hadith of Tirmidhi, hadith number 631, the Prophet said that anyone who possesses wealth with him, or property, but natural, reaching the nisab level, that surplus wealth, for one full year in his possession, then he should pay zakat on it. There is an exception to this rule for farm products, as Allah says in Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 141, that give what is due according to what is proper on the day of harvest. If it's harvest, farm products, give it on the same day. You don't have to wait for 1 year. And according to Imam Abadi, he says there are two types of zakat. One type of zakat is on that goods which cannot be invested. It remains the same, talking about farm products, and that you have to give immediately. And that which can be invested, whether gold, silver, merchandise, so it has to be with you in possession for 1 year. And after it's in possession for 1 year, above the nisab level, then you have to give zakat.
I see. Okay. Thank you for the answer. Next question. Could you tell us something of the wisdom of zakat?
Whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prescribes anything in the Quran, but naturally it has certain wisdom. There are many reasons. And there are various verses in the Quran and the hadith in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his messenger, has given us the wisdom for zakat. Number one is to perfect one's faith. As the beloved Prophet ﷺ said, that zakat makes your faith perfect. And I mentioned earlier that it is one of the pillars of Islam. And the beloved Prophet ﷺ said in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, in the book of faith, hadith number 8, that Islam is based on 5 pillars. The first is to say there's no God but Allah, and Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. Number 2, establishing of salah. Number 3 is giving of zakat. Number 4 is performing hajj. And number 5 is fasting the month of Ramadan. So it makes our faith perfect. Number 2 reason for zakat is that it purifies and cleanses our wealth. As one of the meanings of zakat is to purify, to clean. So it cleans our wealth from the impurities. And therefore, it makes halal for us. Number 3 is it increases. As the Prophet said, it's mentioned in Sahih Muslim, volume number 4, hadith number 6264, that charity does not decrease our wealth. Actually, it increases our wealth. And zakat prevents you from calamity, saves you from loss in fire, and various other things. So indirectly, it increases your wealth. And one of the meaning of zakah is also blessings and goodness. So point number four, zakat brings blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Point number five is that it cleanses your character. It makes your character better. It prevents you from being a miser and it makes you a generous person. Point number six, it makes your heart feel good. The thing you love, and if you give that, especially if you give wealth, it brings the joy in you. Especially if it's giving out of willingness. If it's not given out of willingness, it's given out of reluctancy, then you won't feel happy. So it brings the joy in your heart, the person who gives zakat. Furthermore, it is a sign of belief. Giving zakat is a sign of belief. And our beloved Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, in the Book of Faith, Hadith number 13, the beloved Prophet said that a Muslim is not a true believer until he wants for his Muslim brother the same thing what he wants for himself. And zakat will give you a way to paradise, will make you enter Jannah. The beloved Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, it's a Sahih Hadith mentioned in Sahih Ibn Hibban, volume number 8, Hadith number 3438. A person comes to the Messenger of Allah and tells him that I believe in one God and no other God and believe that Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is the Messenger of God and I establish prayers and I give zakat and I fast in the month of Ramadan and I stand in prayers in the nights of Ramadan. What will happen to me? The Prophet replies, you will be among the Siddiqun, among the pious people and among the Shuhada, among the martyrs. So zakat, that is, you'll be in paradise. So zakat is your way to salvation. It's a way to paradise. Furthermore, when you give zakat, it brings a sense of unity throughout the people of the Muslim Ummah. And as Allah says in Surah Qasas, chapter number 28, verse number 77, do thou good as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has done good to you. So it brings a sense of belongingness amongst the Muslims of the world. And if a rich gives to the poor, then he cares for him. A person who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed with bounties gives to a person who's needy. So it brings a sense of belongingness. Furthermore, point number 10, when you give zakat to the poor, it prevents the poor from revolting towards you. For the poor may see that there are rich people in the world who have got beautiful vehicles to travel in, they've got big houses, they've got luxury. So it may bring a sort of revolt. The moment you care for them and give them zakat, the revolt in them is prevented. Point number 11, it even prevents stealing and robbing. With a person who does not get his basic needs, it may force him to steal or rob. So when zakat is given, the basic need of the poor people are taken care of, so it prevents stealing and robbing and uplifts the whole society. Point number 12, it brings sincerity. Because when we give something which we love, we give it away, you can only give it away for a cause which is equally lovable to you or something which is better. So it shows your faith and love in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore the word sadqa comes from sidq, which means sincerity. So it shows the sincereness in a person. And point number 13, zakat prevents the calamity from the heaven coming onto the earth. Point number 14, our beloved Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, it's mentioned in Sahih Hadith of Musnad Ahmad, Hadith number 17333, the beloved Prophet said that on the day of resurrection, your charity will be a shade for him. That means the person who gives charity, it will be a shade for him on the day of resurrection. Our beloved Prophet also mentioned, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, in the Book of Adhan, Hadith number 660, the beloved Prophet said that on the day of resurrection, seven categories of people will have Allah's shade. the Beloved Prophet said that seven categories of people will have Allah's shade. And his shade will be the only shade that will protect the people. And amongst them, one category is those who give charity secretly so that the left hand doesn't know what the right hand gives. So giving charity, giving zakat, will give you the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of resurrection. Further, it's mentioned in Silsila Sayyah, hadith number 1908, the Beloved Prophet Muhammad said that charity, that is zakat, charity given in secret extinguishes the wrath of the Lord. And further, the Beloved Prophet said, it's mentioned in hadith of Tirmidhi, hadith number 2616, that zakat extinguishes sins the same as water extinguishes fire. So this was the wisdom why zakat has been prescribed for the Muslims by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Furthermore, another question which comes to mind regarding what are the things which zakah becomes an obligation upon the Muslim?
The things on which zakat has to be paid, which is binding on a Muslim, which becomes obligatory on a Muslim. Number one, it is gold. But naturally, all these things should reach the nisab level, then becomes compulsory. Number one is gold. Number two is silver. Number three is jewelry and ornaments which contain gold and silver. Number four is farm products. Number five is the cattle. Number six is merchandise and goods of trade. Number seven is business activities. Number eight is money, or you can say currency notes. And the ninth thing on which zakat is compulsory is the stock in trade. So these are the nine types of category of things on which zakat is compulsory and binding.
Thank you, Dr. Zakir. Next question for you is regarding the prophetic tradition of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There is a nisab on gold and silver. Could you explain that? And is it the same in both cases, gold and silver?
As far as nisab for gold is concerned, the nisab for gold is 85 grams of gold or 7.5 tola gold. That is, one tola of gold is equal to 11.33 grams approximately. So 7.5 tola gold is equal to 85 grams of gold. So if it reaches that nisab level or above this, and if it stays with you for 1 year, then zakat is compulsory. Based on the hadith of Muhammad, which is mentioned in Sunan Abu Dawud, in the book of Zakat, volume number 2, hadith number 1568, where the Beloved Prophet said that zakat is on you, that is on gold, if it reaches 20 dinar. If zakat is not there, if it's less than 20 dinar. If it reaches 20 dinar, then zakat is fard. And 1 dinar is equal to 1 miskal. 1 miskal is 4.25 grams. So 20 by 4.25 comes to 85 grams of gold. So the nisab level for gold is 85 grams of gold. And again, it should be with you for 1 year. And the percentage of zakat is mentioned in the hadith of Ibn Majah, in the book of Zakat, hadith number 1791. It's mentioned that Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, she says that the Prophet used to take half dinar for every 20 dinar and 1 dinar for every 40 dinar. That means 1/40th of the portion, or in percentage wise 2.5%. So whatever gold you have with you, that 85 grams of gold or above, you have to give 2.5% of that gold if it's with you for 1 year in zakat. As far as the nisab for silver is concerned, it is 595 grams of silver or 52.5 tolas of silver, and the percentage of zakat is the same, it is 2.5%. A beloved Prophet said in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 2, in the book of Zakat, hadith number 1447, that zakat is due on 5 okiya of silver. 1 okiya is equal to 40 dirham. So 5 okay is equal to 200 dirham. And 200 dirham is equal to 595 grams or 52 and a half tola. So if the silver reaches the nisab level, the nisab is 595 grams of gold or 52 and a half tola. And the beloved Prophet said in Sunan Abu Dawud, volume number 2, in the book of Zakat, hadith number 1567, that pay 1/40th. That means give 1/40th portion in Zakat. So even for silver, the percentage is 2.5%. So for gold and silver, the Zakat percentage is 2.5%. But the nisab level for gold is 85 grams of gold or 7.5 tola. And for silver, the nisab is 595 grams of silver or 52.5 tola of silver.
Thank you, Dr. Zaki. Relating to the last answer, if a person has gold or silver jewelry which they intend to use, do they have to pay zakat on that?
As far as paying zakat on gold and silver jewelry, if a person is using it, there's a difference of opinion. One group of scholars say that zakat need not be given, while the other group of scholars say that zakat should be given. According to the scholars like Imam Malik, Imam Shafi, and Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, may Allah have mercy on them, all of them say that zakat need not be given on gold and silver jewelry if it is being used. Based on the hadith of Al-Bayhaqi, where Jabir ibn Abdullah, may Allah be pleased with him, many have asked that is zakat liable on gold and silver jewelry if it is being used. He said that zakat is not liable even if it's 1,000 dinar. 1,000 dinar worth of gold, then zakat is not liable. It's mentioned in hadith of Bayhaqi that Asma bint Abi Bakr, the daughter of Hazrat Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, she used to put jewelry on her children, on her daughters, and the jewelry was more than 50,000 dinar of gold. But yet she never used to pay zakat. And another hadith, which is mentioned in Mu'tal al-Malik, that Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, the wife of the Prophet, she used to take care of her nieces who wore gold jewelry, but she never paid zakat on that. So based on this hadith, all the hadiths I say, based on these three hadiths and other some hadith, that these scholars say that zakat need not be given. But the other group of scholars, like Abu Hanifa, Ibn Hazm, may Allah have mercy on them, these group of scholars, they say that zakat should be given on gold jewelry, even if it's worn. And they give various verses of the Quran and the hadith. For example, Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, verse number 34 and 35, that as to those who hoard gold and silver and spend it not in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning those who don't give zakat, announce to them a grievous penalty. And that wealth will be heated in the fire of hell. And with that, they'll be branded on their forehead, on their flanks and on the back. And it will be told to them that have the taste of wealth that he hoarded. So here it says that anyone does not give zakat on gold and silver, hoard it and don't give zakat, you'll be banned with fire. So based on this verse of the Quran, they say irrespective whether you're using it or not, you have to pay zakat. And the hadith of Muhammad in Sahih Muslim, volume number 2, in the book of Zakat, hadith number 2161, that all those who hoard gold and silver and spend it on the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a plate of fire would be made on the day. And they would be heated in the hellfire, and with them they would be branded on the flanks, on the forehead, and on the backs. And then he recited the verse of the Quran, of Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, verse 780, that those would not spend in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And further, there is a hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is mentioned in Sunan Abu Dawud, volume number 2, in the book of Zakat, hadith number 1558, where a lady comes along with her daughter wearing two heavy bangles of gold. And when they approached the Prophet asked that, have you paid zakat on that? So they said no. So the Prophet said that, do you want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to put bangles of fire around your hands? So immediately that lady, she removes the bangles and gives it to the Prophet and says, I give it in the way of Allah and His Rasul. There's another hadith mentioned in Sunan Abu Dawud, volume number 2, in the book of Zakat, hadith number 1560. Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, the wife of the Prophet, one day she wears 2 rings of silver, and the Prophet enters and sees these 2 rings of silver. So he asks her, now what is this? So she says that I made myself for you, O Messenger of Allah. So the Prophet asked her, did you pay zakat? So she says, no, or as Allah wills. So the Prophet replies, that is sufficient for you to take you to hellfire. So based on this hadith, the scholars say that zakat is fard on the jewelry, even if it's worn, if it contains gold and silver. And the second ruling of the scholars, that zakat is fard, is more stronger and is more correct, though they differ in the opinion, but that is more followed by the people. And because better gives zakat rather than stay away from it, it always gets sawab in that. Therefore, most of the scholars agree in the second view, though the scholars do differ among the scholars who say zakat is not fard on gold and silver jewelry is Jabir ibn Abdullah, Abdullah ibn Umar, Asma bint Abi Bakr, may Allah be pleased with them all, Imam Malik, Imam Shafi, Imam Ibn Hanbal, may Allah have mercy on them. These scholars say that zakat is not fard. With the other group of scholars say zakat is fard, amongst them, we have Hazrat Umar ibn al-Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, Abdullah ibn Masud, Abdullah ibn Abbas, we have Sufyan Thawri, may Allah be pleased with them all, Imam Abu Hanifa, may Allah have mercy on him, Ibn Muntab, Ibn Hazm, may Allah have mercy on them all, Sheikh Utaymi, Sheikh bin Baz, may Allah have mercy on them all. So all these scholars, they say that zakat is fard on gold jewelry, if it reaches any nisab level. If it doesn't reach, it's not fard. And the second view, that is fard, is more authentic, is more stronger, but there are different opinions among the scholars.
JazakAllah khair.
So Zakir, what is the correct nisab for farm produce?
As far as farm produce is concerned, all farm produce are not liable for zakat. Farm produce such as seeds and fruits, such as wheat, barley, rice, date, raisin, coffee, cocoa, pistachio, cashew, all of them, they are liable for zakat. And the 2 Quranic verses speak about that. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 267. Give of what you have lawfully earned. Give of the good things that you have earned and the fruits of the earth which we have produced for you. So it says that give of the farm products. Further, it's mentioned in Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 141, that what is due, give it proper on the day of harvest. On the day of harvest, you have to give it. The nisab for farm produce is 5 asak, which is equivalent to 612 kilograms kgs, and which is equivalent to 1346.4 pounds. This is the nisab level. If it's less than this, then you should not give zakat. And there are 2 types of farm produce. One type, which zakat is only liable on those farm produce which are used as food and they can be stored naturally without refrigeration. As I mentioned, wheat, rice, barley, cocoa, they can be stored. Zakat is liable on that. But if it's a farm produce which is perishable, like fruits such as grapes, such as banana, such as mango, all of them, they are perishable, so zakat is not liable on them. And as I mentioned, on farm produce, which can be stored, it should be given on the day of harvest. And those are perishable, you should not give. Now, there are 2 types of farm produce. One farm produce, which does not require any human labor or irrigation, and they are watered by the rainwater. no human labor is required, no irrigation. On this farm produce, 10% zakat is liable, 10%. Should be given on the day of harvest. And those on which water is required by the human beings, that is man-made irrigation, or labor is required, on them 5% zakat is liable on the day of harvest. And for those items which are perishable, fruits, etc., like orange, mango, banana, grapes, all of them zakat is not liable. But if you sell and if you make a profit, and if that profit is kept with you for a year, and if it reaches above nisab level, then zakat is liable on them.
Okay. Dr. Zakir, last question for you today is regarding the nisab level for cattle or livestock. Could you say a few words about that?
As far as animals is concerned, only those animals that are used for grazing, that freely graze, and you don't have to feed them, no one doesn't have to feed them, like camels, cows, goats, sheep, on them, zakat is liable. For other animals where the owner has to feed them with hay, like horse, etc., for them, zakat is not liable. But naturally, if it's sold and if the money is used and the money is kept and if it reaches above nisab, will keep with you for 1 year, then zakat is liable. But generally, directly zakat is only on the cattle, camel, cow, goat, sheep. And the nisab level for camel is 5 camels. For the cow, it is 30. And for goat and sheep, it is 40. And there's a hadith of Muhammad. It's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 2, in the book of zakat, hadith number 1454, that Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, he said that he'll take zakat from the people and he gives Allah's messenger. He quotes him and says that he said that for every 5 camels, 1 sheep should be given. The nisab for the camel is 5, and for every 5 camels, 1 sheep should be given in zakat. And as the camels keep on increasing, zakat keeps on changing. For the sheep, once it reaches 40, then you have to give 1 sheep. Below 40, there's no zakat. 40 is the nisab level for the sheep. If it reaches 40, then 1 sheep should be given. Between 40 and 120, it is 1 sheep. Between 120 and 200 sheep, it is 2 sheep. Between 200 and 300 sheep, it is 3 sheep. And then additionally, for every 100 sheep, there's 1 sheep. This is a zakat. So the minimum zakat, the minimum percentage, people think that 2.5% is fixed on everything. On most of the things, it's 2.5%. But the minimum is, if you have 119 sheep, it is 1 sheep. So it comes to about 0.82%. The lowest zakat is on sheep 0.82%. On average, if it goes above 200, 300, it is 1%. For 300, it is 3. For 200, it is 2. And the average is 2.5% for most of the things. And the highest, as we discussed earlier, for farm produce, which does not require irrigation, by rainwater is irrigated, for that is 10%. Maximum is 10%. For farm produce, which requires irrigation, 5%. Lowest, as I mentioned, in cattle, it is 1% or 0.82%, but majority is 2.5% zakat.
Jazakallah khair, Dr. Zakir, once again, for lots and lots of very important information on the topic zakat. And of course, it's a highly technical subject, and I think it's taken us a little bit longer to explain. Even the questions were a little bit more difficult for me even today. But alhamdulillah, we got to the end of the program. So, brothers and sisters, if you wish to learn more about the technicalities of zakat, you must join us at the same time tomorrow. And I would urge you to do so, because it's incredibly important. Tomorrow, we'll be mostly discussing zakat part 2. Join us then. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. قانتين خاشعين مسلمين مؤمنين للإله عابدين شهرنا صوم وعتق وقنوت فيه صدق يومنا صبر ورفق بدموع البائسين رمضان قد أهل بالصيام وأطلى مسعدا أهلا وخلا لتهو